Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua-Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Lord, we come to you this morning and we just love the way that you can speak to each one of us, whatever challenges we're facing this week. Lord, you know us intimately and you know what we need to hear to be encouraged. So I pray now that you use Pastor Izzy, even as he's sick, Lord, I pray that you'd give him strength, Lord, to use him as a vessel to speak to each one of us, to encourage our faith and our walk with you. And we ask that now in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, guys, would you turn in your Bibles to the end of 1 John chapter 3, the last two verses we're going to be studying into chapter 4 this morning. So 1 John chapter 3, verse 23, where we see what his commandment is. Now, if you weren't with us here last week, I know it was a small group up at my house due to rain, but I'm so grateful for the feeding crew that still came down here and fed the homeless and just shared the love of the Lord with them. And, you know, this is the commandment that John wrote that he says is God's command to us. You know, some of you, what does God really want me to do? You ever heard that? If there's a real God, what does he want? Well, here's his commandment. It's pretty tough. Ready? It says his commandment is first that you believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ. And it's a two-part commandment, by the way. And the second part, you guys already know because John's been harping on this one a bit. What is the second part? That we what? That we love one another. Now, if we do this, these two things, believe in his Son. Remember, Jesus was questioned by that attorney, what do I do to have everlasting life? And he says, you just believe on him whom God has sent. This is the work you must do. Just believe on him whom God has sent. Who did God send? Jesus, his Son. And if anyone ever says to you, I wish God, if he was really real, would show himself, that he would show me that he's real, that he's there. Well, the answer is he already did. And that's something that we get the privilege to just, I'm not really proclaiming any new news. I'm proclaiming what's already been done. And it's, you know, if you didn't grow up getting to hear this, it might be new to you, but it's not new to the world. I want you to know that this is news that's been around for a couple, millennia? Yeah, millennia. I was trying to think of the word in English. Mille is in Italian, thousands of years. This has been since Christ came to this world. But it is a legitimate question. When your friends ask you, if God is real, I wish you would just show himself. Like, if he's the creator of everything, why can't he just come down here and show himself? Has anyone ever thought that when you were, you know, pondering God and thinking about his existence? If you've ever thought that, that's a good question that's going through your mind, because that's legitimate. You know, when you're thinking that, it's because God put that in your spirit to think that. And your spirit craves an answer to that. And the answer is, well, he already did. He came in the form of a baby. It says Jesus humbled himself, laid aside his godhood, and became man to dwell amongst us. And that he would grow up on this earth before us. It's a very humbling. You might not think it's humbling, but what if you were God, the Son of God, and then you traded in for in a little, you know, in a feeding trough of all places. I mean, if I was God and I'm sending my boy down to be born, I would have had him build a hospital for him. You know, private wing, everything. But no, there's no room for him even in the inn. And where does he have to wind up being laid that first night? In a stable where the animals are kept. I mean, no one can even be jealous of Jesus' entry to this world. He came, it says, humbly. But he came humbly because humility is easy for us to approach. When somebody's humble, we don't feel like there's a wall between us and them. It feels like we can come to them. And that's how the Lord wanted. He wanted it so we could come to him. We could approach him. And so here's the command John says we have to do. Now, this command was attached to the verse before it where it says that we can ask anything of God and receive an answer from him. But it was a conditional asking. Did you see the condition? Look at verse 22. And whatever we ask, we receive from God because we keep his what? Commandments. And we do the things that are pleasing in his sight. If you keep these commandments, you believe in Jesus and you love one another, you can have confidence to go to God and say, God, I need something from you. You can ask anything. He says, ask him every day. Ask this day your daily bread. He'll provide. Whatever you need, he has no trouble with being the God that answers our prayers. But he does put a condition. I don't know if you know. It says, and whatever we ask, we receive because we keep his commandments. John's trying to say, you guys know that this is a foregone conclusion. You do keep his commandments, right? You do believe in his son. You do love one another. Because you do, you can ask whatever you want. And you can go to God in confidence. You don't have to be ashamed or afraid because he welcomes you. In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16, it says, let us draw near with confidence to the throne of what? Of grace. That we could receive grace and mercy in our time of need. Whenever we need grace and mercy, anyone, by the way, need grace and mercy for this week? Take some, yeah? Well, take a lot. Meet, Lord, I need extra. Well, we can draw near to his throne of grace with confidence because he wants us to. He looks at us as his children. And when we were obedient children, I know how it is for me in an earthly perspective, as earthly parents, when our children are behaving and they're loving one another. You know, when I know some of you are laughing because you're thinking, not my kids. But I mean, when your kids are getting along, right, and they're loving one another and they're obeying what you've told them, is it a trouble for us as parents when they come to us and ask us for things to want to give to our kid? It is such a naturally inbred thing. We want to give them those good things. How much more does our Heavenly Father want to give us good things? But how about when your kids are fighting and beating on one another, and I hate you, I want to kill you, and then, Dad, give me this, Dad, I want... I remember at one of the youth groups, one of the kids actually asked this because he knew my scoutmaster in Boy Scouts when I did Eagle Scouts, when we had this one scoutmaster at the Mormon church, he was the pyromaniac of the world. I mean, this guy was a chemist genius. And when I got my little fire, I don't know if you guys know anything about Boy Scouts, but you have to get these merit badges. And when I got my merit badge for fire making, I didn't just learn how to make fire with rubbing sticks or doing little spindles or little trough boats. I learned all sorts of ways to start fire. Because I had this genius chemistry Boy Scout master who taught us, now you go home and ask your mom for some of this chemical. It's in this certain, in the Comet cleaner. Bring me a little baggie of that, and you go home and get me this. And he would send us on missions to get these different chemicals, household chemicals. See, but he had gone to Vietnam, and he had learned how to take those chemicals and put them together in the right way so as to make kabooms. I mean, fire, right, yeah, just fire. We rigged little wires from a tree real far away, and we put our bonfire like 40 feet away, and we put some of the chemicals sprinkled on the wood, and he was going to show us what would happen when that chemical is introduced to this little jar with this liquid, and we sent it down the wire, and it hits and, cracks open the glass, and all of a sudden, instant bonfire. And we were like, this is great, just knowing what to put together. Now, I'm not going to teach you that. Because you guys, some of you are too, your eyes look too eager to learn that. Fire starting 101, but if I could teach you how to put together. one of the kids, he knew that I knew how to do this. And he actually came in to me at youth group and said he was mad at two of the other kids because they had been hanging out and they were talking about him and they were mad at each other and they were fighting. And he said, could you teach me how to make a bomb? Because you know how to do it. You did the Eagle Scout thing, and he knew. Because he knew of my scoutmaster, and he's like, you had that good guy, that really good chemist guy. Can you show me how to make a bomb? And I'm like, why? Why do you want to make a bomb? You want to learn how to start a fire? He's like, no. I don't blow those two guys up, man. They drive me crazy. I thought, it's not the knowledge of how to combine the stuff that's the danger. It's the heart within the person who knows how to combine this stuff. Because we could use it to start fires and you know, keep warm on a camp out, but he wanted to use it literally to do harm. And when someone comes to you and they're asking something of you that you have the ability to give them and the knowledge of how to pass on that thing, but you see within them that they do not love, is it good to give them the knowledge? Should I just say, oh, sure, here, combine this and this and this, and, you know, instant explosion, you know? And I mean, this scoutmaster kept us way far away from those chemicals when they combined, because he knew how violent the ignition would be when they came in contact. And this is supervised. This is someone who cared about us passing on this knowledge. But not for the purpose of using it to hurt. When your kids come to you and they're like, Dad, give me a knife. And you're like, why? You want to cut an apple and have some peanut butter with it? Or, no, I want to kill my sister. Not that any of you ever taught that toward your sibling, right? Or your spouse. Sometimes some of you are asking of things of God and you're wondering, why am I not getting my answer? There's a condition here. Whatever we ask, we receive from him because we do these two things. First, we believe in his son. And second, we have to love one another. If we don't love one another, sorry, don't come to me and say, but I prayed and prayed. God would tell me how to do this. You know, how to hurt this person who's hurt me. How to get vengeance. How to blow him up. What's wrong with God? Why doesn't he answer my prayers? I said, because you don't have love. And you're not walking in the faith that was delivered through his son. You need to come to faith in Jesus and come to love. And this love is so important. Let me show you. The next chapter of 1 John, 1 John chapter 4, is going to just, I mean, there's no way to skirt around it. It pounds home the point you have to love one another. It's not even optional. So if you don't like the idea that you have to love somebody, you ought to get up and go now. Because this message, this is literally what the scripture preaches. This is what Jesus passed on to John the Apostle, and John the Apostle is passing on to us. In 1 John chapter 4, read with me here. It says, he says, listen to this. Beloved, he says, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. Because there are many false prophets that have gone out into the world. And by this, you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh, is from God. Now, every spirit that does not confess Jesus, does not confess that Jesus is from God, it says that is the spirit of what? The Antichrist, of which you have heard, is coming and now is already in the world. He says, you are from God, little children, and you have overcome them, because greater is he who is in you than he who is what? In the world. Listen, there is a spirit of Antichrist that says, Jesus didn't come. You know, there are people who actually believe that. I'm like, wake up. You know, it's so weird to me that my son and I just watched on the TV, Man of Steel. It was a remake about Superman, how he came, you know, to this planet, and he grew up as a little, you know, he arrived as a baby. It gave the whole backstory, and he lived amongst us, but he didn't, you know, his dad said, don't show yourself to the people, that you'll be afraid of you. You'll be like a god to them. And his dad was El, which I don't know if you know Hebrew, but El stands for what? God, Elohim, the name of God, and he comes and he lives amongst us. And I'm watching this with Daniel. I'm like, Daniel, do you see any parallels to this in the Bible? You know, that and at age 33 he reveals himself to the world because Zod has come and he's gonna destroy the world if Superman doesn't deliver himself over to Zod. And so he surrenders himself as an offering, basically, to the bad guy, right? Now, does that have any parallels to what Christ did? You know, more people will believe the story of Superman than will believe the gospel sometimes, though. It makes me sad that there are such comic book groupies that they know the details, but they don't know that we're talking about a real story where God really did send his son, and his son did grow up amongst us, and, gee, he revealed himself at age 30 publicly and walked amongst us teaching for 3 years to when then he surrenders himself as an offering. He said, no man takes my life, I give it. And he gave his life for us. And that, by the way, that very act of his coming into this world has changed world history. It has changed the calendars globally. All around the world, if someone says to you, I don't know if God's really out there, you know, why doesn't he show himself? And you tell him, he did. They're like, well, I don't think so. And just play stupid. Just do this. This is what I do. I say, help me out. What's that AD BC thing on the calendar? You know, that BC, let me think. What is it? Is it before Crayolas? Before cookies? Right? Before, and you know what they'll do to you? I mean, even the non-believers will say, that's before Christ, stupid. Don't you know? And I'm like, yeah, I knew. But you just told me God didn't show himself, and I'm telling you he did in his son. And that before Christ, AD stands from, it's from the Latin, Anni Domini. It means Anni is the Latin for the year, and Domini is the dominant one, the year, or we translate the year of the Lord. You know, if you're Lord, you're the master, the dominant one, the one that rules. The year of the Lord. So all of time has been measured BC leading up to the promise that God would send his Messiah before the Christ, and then after the Christ. I know some people think AD is after, but that's a good way to think about it. I mean, it's after he arrived, okay? It's the year of the Lord. Beginning with that, when he was born, that's when we mark time forward from the promise being fulfilled. It's on the calendars all around the world. The Bible even tells us in the last days that they will try to change the way that time's kept. Did you know this is told to us in the scripture? That they will try to change it because it's too much of a testimony that Christ came. And ironically, the place that it got changed first that I was made aware of it was over in Israel. I was going on a tour, I guess it's been about 15 years ago, they started saying, instead of saying AD and BC, they started saying ACE and BCE. I'm like, what's BCE? I've never heard BCE anywhere. They say BCE, before common era, and ACE, after. Or CE. Well, my guide said ACE, after common era. That was my guide. He was trying to educate me. Before common era, Jan's telling me they're saying now, before common era, BCE and CE. Just, you know, just common era. Okay. Why would they want to get rid of a testimony that Christ came? See, it says right here, John said that there is a spirit that has come into this world. He says, and every spirit that confesses Jesus Christ has come in the flesh, they're from God. If they say that he has not come in the flesh, and by the way, do any of you know people that say, oh, Jesus didn't really come, he's like a fable or a fairy tale? It's like comic book. There's actually people who believe that he did not actually physically come to this earth. Let me just make you aware. This is John's writing this, and this is only, you know, the early church has only been going, by the time he writes 1 John, this is around what, I believe we get this book some scholars say around the 60s. So about 30 years later, only three decades later, and there were already people saying, after 30 years. 30 years go by, and they're like, he didn't really come. You know, like, right now, it's been 70 years since the Holocaust happened. Do you know that there's people saying the Holocaust never happened? Have you heard that? They're actually teaching this in some of the schools now. It didn't really happen. We have people who are still alive that survived through the camps, the internment camps, and they still have the tattoos on their arms that were given to them by the Nazis, and they're saying it didn't really happen. It's that old saying, you know, those that don't want to study history and learn the mistakes of the history are doomed to repeat them. You know, Satan loves us to be short-minded in remembering things what have happened before because it's such an easy way for him to lull us into disbelief. If he can get you to believe it never happened, and John's saying, can you imagine 30 years have passed since Jesus had died and rose from the dead, and already he said there was people saying he never really physically came to the earth. 30 years later, John's going, I was there. I touched him. Remember what the book started off with, this First John? He said, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have beheld, our hands have handled, we proclaim to you. We were with him. We were there. Eyewitness of Christ coming in the flesh is, this is, by the way, when you say, why are you so big on this book? These guys were there. They're not talking about, you know, this would be like saying to someone you want to find out if the Holocaust happened and stuff, and you had a real person who was alive, one of your relatives who was there. Is anyone else like me, like, where you prefer to have someone who is actually there tell you the details rather than some guy who was never there, who just makes up a story? Not me, man. I want the guy who was there. John was there. He says, I was there. I touched him. I leaned on his breast at the Last Supper. I'm the disciple whom Jesus loved, by the way. That's what he said, right? He knew that he was loved of the Lord. Now he's going to go on and tell us about that love and how do we have to operate in that love. Because he's telling us, guys, listen, that spirit is out there that denies Christ coming, that spirit of the Antichrist. But God's spirit in you is greater than that spirit. Remember this. And he said, and they are from the world, verse 5 says, therefore they speak as from the world, and the world listens to them. But we are from God. And God, it says, and he knows, we are from God, and he who knows God, it says, listens to us. He who is not from God does not listen to us. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. You know, when someone is from God and you speak about the things of God, there's just a connection that happens. You understand? There's like a deep understanding. You don't even have to be around. You can meet Christians from anywhere else in the world, and all of a sudden there's this instant connection. You get it. You get each other. You're like speaking the same language. But it's since I speak other languages, and I had to learn English as my second language, I grew up speaking Italian at home. I can tell you from someone who's experienced with speaking another language, when I speak Italian to people who speak Italian, it's no trouble. We just connect right away. But if I speak Italian to people that don't speak Italian, they look at me like a deer in headlights, you know? And they just, huh? And there's no connection going on. It's like when you're talking about God to someone who's not walking with God, and they're looking at you like you're from another planet. Anyone know what I'm expressing here? You ever had this feeling? You're talking about God with somebody, and they don't believe, and they're just looking at you like, you're from Mars, man. What is your problem? John says, listen, we are from God, and he who knows God listens to us. He who does not know God, he does not listen. And by this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. There is a spirit of error out there, where people are erring in their ways. They're not following the faith what God has given to them. They're not loving their brethren. Now, verse 7, we sing this as a song. We sang it this morning. Beloved, let us what? love one another, for love is from God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. And the one who does not love, he says, does not know God, for God is love. This is so important, guys. God is love. If someone says, I know God, but I hate that guy over there. Let me read to you what John has to say about this. He says, verse 9 says, by this the love of God was manifested in us, that God has sent his only Son, his only begotten Son, into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us. And he sent his Son to be a propitiation, a payment for our sins. Beloved, he says, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. And no one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected. So it says, well, have you seen God? No. Have you tasted of his love? Yes. That's the don't ever get fooled into thinking the proof of God's existence is if you've seen him. By the way, if you had seen him, the Bible tells us very clearly, no man has seen God and lived. There's a little catch there. The and lived part, right? Well, why can't man just go before God the way we are? Why can't we stand before a holy, pure God in our unholy, sinful state? What would happen to us? Yeah, we'd burn up. You know, we'd be goners. I mean, in a corruptible being before an incorruptible holy God, we'd be consumed. So the proof that God's existence is not, have I seen him? In fact, that's a danger to have some guy, and by the way, the devil, he's a twister of the scriptures, and he knows how to get some people sidetracked and say, well, have you seen God? Is he really real? We just went over this last week. Have you seen, I always tell him, look, have you seen gravity? I used to say, have you seen air? But I've lived in Kona too long. The Vog, you can actually see air. When I was growing up, I never thought that we could see air, but I'm kind of becoming convinced that it gets kind of gloomy. Look down there. You can actually see the air. You know, when it blocks out the mountain, that's seeing air. And but even though it's an example of something what we consider invisible, is it still powerful? Do we still need it to function? And people who say, the proof of seeing is believing is the wrong proof. I submit to you, God did not want you to go with such a superficial thing to prove an eternal holy being is there. Instead, he says, you want proof that I'm there? What proof does he say? Love one another. As I have loved you. Love is a greater proof that God is there. When people say, prove to me that God is there, that God would take my heart that was filled with hatred and rage and replace that with his love, shows me that there is a greater being than any man. Because man can't do that to other men. So I go, let's go with something of substance. Now, you say, but you can't see love. So if I was like one of those rational people, if I can't see it, I don't believe it. So, okay, love doesn't exist. Air doesn't exist. Gravity doesn't exist. Does that make me float up and hover? No gravity. I don't believe in it. Just because you don't believe in something doesn't mean it doesn't have power over you. Doesn't mean you don't have dependence on it every day. You still need that air. Your little lungs have to suck that air in every day. And you don't even see it. And yet we have a loving God who put things that you do not see in your life to look after you. And he was so smart, he made sure he put the things that are like pertinent to life, like your heart ticking, your lungs continually expanding and contracting, sucking in that air and blowing it out and doing it constantly. You know, those things are on what we call the subconscious level. Wonder why he did that. Can you imagine if we had to consciously think of breathing all the time? Some of you'd forget. Or you'd get busy. You'd be like texting and forget to breathe. We'd watch people pass out with their phones. What happened to him? Oh, he forgot to breathe. God was smart. He put all the things that you need done in your body on his control. I submit that to you, that he wired you, hardwired to do certain things. And you go, well, who did that? Well, no one has seen God at any time. And if we love one another, God abides in us. And in this, he says, this is his love. In his love, this is the completeness, the perfection for us. This is what it is. When we abide in his love, we love one another, God will abide in us. His love will be perfected in us. And by this we know that we abide in him and that he abides in us because he has given his Spirit. Thank you, Lord, for your Spirit. We need his Spirit. Well, it says, we have seen and testify that the Father has sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. John is saying, we have seen him. We got a firsthand witness that Christ did come to this earth. And yet, we live in an era where guys are saying, oh, that's just a fable. That's like thousands of years ago, you know, millennial. It's probably not even happened. We need to change that BC AD thing. We'll just call it BCE and CE. Because we wouldn't want the world to know that the Messiah actually came. But I'm here to tell you, he did come. And he came and he gave us his command. God gave us a command. Believe in his Son and love one another. Now today, I get super blessed to have Monty and Mia back with us and their kids and get to baptize Heidi today into Christ. Now, she's already read Romans 6, and she knows that we went over this just before the service. But for those of you that will be witnesses today, I want you to help me encourage this young lady. This is an awesome thing, at age 12, to put her faith in the Lord and want to be baptized into Jesus. What a honor to get to do this, that these guys would come back and visit us. And I want you guys to come with me to the water's edge when we do this and witness her. Because we don't baptize you into our church. We baptize, like it teaches in Romans, we baptize you into Christ. And just so that you know, when I get out there in the water, I'll say, I baptize you, Heidi, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. That's what they did in the book of Acts. I cover all the bases because I know some people have these different theologies that they like to argue over, which I think is a big distraction. We're supposed to take the person in baptism and we join them to Christ. And Christ, when you are joined to Christ, you have power. Power over sin, over death, over temptation. You know, and this is part of the thing. I know a lot of preachers that emphasize that, you know, they preach from the book of Acts. Repent and be baptized and ye shall be what? Saved. Absolutely. But if you go on in the New Testament and read a little further and you get to the next book after Acts, it's called the book of Romans. And in chapter 6 of Romans, Paul says that, when don't you know that you who are baptized into Christ, that you're baptized into the likeness of his death? So just as he died to sin, so you too consider yourselves to be dead to sin. And then he says, and just like Christ rose from the dead to the glory of the Father, so you too, when you get baptized, you get to join Jesus, not just in his death. You know, the water is a symbolic grave. We're going to go bury Heidi today. Okay? But she said, yay. And we're going to bury her with Christ. But then when we pull her up out of the water symbolically, we joined her first in the death with Jesus, to his death. And then what did he do after 3 days? He resurrected. And we join her now in that resurrected life, that newness. Paul says, so you can walk in newness of life. Now, so many Christians are unaware of what it teaches in Romans 6. That when, don't you know, when you get baptized into Christ, you joined yourself to him. And now you can consider with your mind, just like Christ has died to sin, So you have died to sin. So whenever sin should appear as a temptation at your doorstep, not did that ever anyone ever have that happen to you? Amen? Sin just doesn't matter how long you're a Christian. Sin always seems to try to show up to... What's the wages of sin? Death. We don't need any death. But sometimes the devil, he puts it in a really glitzy wrapper. I mean, he doesn't say, hey, inside this is death. He just says, don't you like the outside wrapping? Isn't it pretty bow? I made it look nice. Here, take this. And he'll wrap sin up in some package that looks really good on the outside. Inside is death. But it's so he can deceive you. And sometimes we get pulled, tempted to go open that package, to play with that toy. And we have to consider now. We use our minds. By the way, when you come to this fellowship, like Aaron said, you don't check your mind at the door and look just for some emotional experience. Use your mind. And when Paul wrote that letter, that epistle to the church at Rome, he said, consider with your mind. You are now joined to Jesus in death first, dead to sin. But then he says, as he rose, you joined to him in life, right? Resurrection, new life. So you join him in death, dead to sin. You join him in newness of life, alive to what? To God. No longer does sin have power over you. This is the first time in my life when I realized what Paul was teaching is freedom. I don't have to sin. I mean, before I was a Christian, it wasn't like I got up and said, I'm not going to sin today. Right? No, did anyone? I was like, which sin and how much? I never even crossed my mind to think, I don't have to do this. I didn't have any power not to. Seems like when the packaging was around, I was like a kid in a candy shop. Just tear it open. Oh, look at all this fun stuff. And you start playing with these things not knowing those toys are going to explode on you down the road. You know, death is involved, but the devil doesn't like let the... Sometimes you get to play with it for a while before it stings you. He like lets you... Think you get lulled into a false sense of security. Oh, I'm fine with this sin. Nothing ever happens to me. I do this one all the time. Play with it all the time. That's a devil deceiving you. We are designed to walk in newness of life. Alive to God, dead to sin. Whenever sin comes up and presents itself, I just go, I've died to that. I died with Christ. When I got baptized, I died to that. Now I'm alive to God. God, how do you want me to live? I don't have to do sin. I actually, this is what baptism has such a powerful message. We can actually say no to sin. Because who are we joined to? Not Amazing Grace. No, who are you joined to? Jesus. That's the power. That's who you have to join yourself to, Christ. And when you join yourself to him, sin can be there and you'll just go, sorry, I died with Christ to that. Now I'm alive to God. What do you want me to do, God? I don't have to sit no more. It's the coolest thing. And this is something the New Testament teaches. How many of you guys have heard preaching on this? A few of you have. Good. I mean, some preachers are sticking to the book. You know, I'm amazed. Some people come up and go, wow, Pastor, that was really good. You know, and I'm thinking that like that was so refreshing here in the Bible, and I'm thinking, so refreshing here in the Bible. You should be don't go to a church where they don't teach you what the Bible teaches you. Do not go there. I'm sorry. You know, Bible says in the end days they'll heap up teachers to tickle their what? Their ears. Go where they will teach you the Word of God and root you and ground you in His Word, so you will know. You'll have discernment. You know, your spirit will be discerning. You'll be like, hey, that, you know, some red alert, you know, somebody's fooling around with something. That's wrong. You need to have that healthy diet of God's Word come into strengthening you. And we got guys who are right there saying, listen, Christ really did come. And today we're going to go join Heidi. So let's pray and take her to the waters. If you're willing to stick around with us, walk us over there to the cakey pond right over there. Our baptismal font is already prepared, and we'll join her to Christ. Let's pray. Father, thank you for letting us have the privilege to see this young one want to be joined to your son. Lord, I'm so grateful for Heidi and her heart to desire this. And I pray today, as she comes before all these other believers, to just publicly make a proclamation of her faith, Lord, that you would meet her in a special way in these waters of baptism. You would make her experience things for what you have for her life, your spirit poured out in her to go on to do whatever things you have for her. Your calling on her life, Lord, we just pray for her right now as a body of believers. This would be a unique and growth experiencing time for her faith. And we thank you, Lord, for her family returning to us. Lord, please open a door for Monty and Mia to come back with their kids in a more permanent way. In Jesus' name I ask. And anyone who agreed with me said, amen. Amen. See you.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.